So this is our shipping department, but we also, because it's going out the door, we final test our Tesla drive units. And this is one that they're putting on the bench. They're gonna test it for a car that they're putting it in next door right now.
So let me get this right then. So what I'm staring at here, that is basically the very powerful motor from a Tesla.
Right.
You know, when people think of an engine, they think of spark plugs, distributor leads, the water jacket, it has to be cooled.
Right.
All of that stuff, all that's gone away with, and what you're left with is
all of it. There's a lot of principles that are the same, but in its core, you know, we do have a water jacket around the motor. We have the motor controller over here that's internally cooled with coolant. We've got basically a 10-to-1 reduction gear in the middle here. So the motor spins at a really high RPM, about 17,000 RPM red line.
17,000, I just want to get that in my head. It's like Formula One. Yeah. 17,000. Yeah. A standard car's about 6,000 RPM. If you get one of those VTEC Hondas, 8,800 RPM, and it sounds like it's going to explode.
And of course, the big advantage is just the torque multiplier. So you're doing, you know, over 400 foot-pounds out of the motor. So at the axle, you've got about 4,000 foot-pounds of torque.
Torque straight away.
That's where you get that instant acceleration, the wheel spin, all the stuff that makes an electric car fun. We're not doing this to save the environment. We're doing this because it's fun.
If you're wondering why we're talking about Tesla so much, it's because they pretty much created the electric luxury car market. With so many Teslas on the road, they're a ready and consistent source of power plants for EV West.
These are the original front subframe jigs. So these have been in use since 1959.
No!
A jig is basically a frame with pegs and clamps to ensure that the assembly of different panels happens the same way every single time.
So every mini then that rolled off the production line from 1959 would have come through these machines?
Yeah.
Because some people would say, when you're remanufacturing body shells, they're saying, well, you're just buying a new part.
Yeah.
But you're not, are you? Because you're buying an old new part, if you like.
Still produced off the original jigs.
Some people may even say that, you know, the soul of the car is lost. But actually, it isn't. The soul of the car is right here in this machine.
Yeah, because everyone's come off these jigs from day one.
You think about the archives and these jigs and all the other tools and knowledge here, and the only real difference between mini bodies assembled at the old factory and the ones assembled here is the passage of time.
So I know if I come and get a mini shell, it's an original mini body shell.
Built the same process, same standards.
Brilliant, brilliant. Can we see one being made?
Unfortunately, you can't. It takes about 4 days prep.
The bad news is that Martin doesn't have anything prepped for these jigs, so I can't see them in action. The good news is, well, everything else is here.
All right, nice to see your machine. Still doing its job after 60 years.
This is a full disc for a valve coach.
Oh, the same coach that was used in the Italian job.
Yeah, that's right, at the end.
I love that coach. That's fantastic. So you're making a disc for one. That'd be a big thing, wouldn't it?
Yes, yeah.
So how does it start?
Basically, we take a stainless steel blank. We put the three holes in the centre. That's the fitting for the bracket.
I'm laughing to myself because that is just it looks like a tray at the moment. That's just a piece of stainless steel, flat, and somehow that's going to turn into a hubcap.
Yeah.
This is magic. When I said you're going to see some magic, you're really going to see some magic.
This is actually household soap. This is a Tufnell, which is a plastic.
Right, gotcha.
Basically, you're just manipulating the metal, moving it backwards and forwards to try and stretch it. You don't want to stretch it too much because it'll just break. So you just find a limit to the metal.
What
Paul is doing is just applied leverage. The basic technique is about as old as civilization itself, being descended from the first pottery wheels used by ancient Sumerians thousands of years ago. And I'd like to note that this is probably the first car show to ever talk about ancient Sumerians.
So we put the first shape in it.
Let's have a look. So already you can see, look, that flat disc has now
see a bit of
got no shapes in it. That's brilliant.
Yeah.
What's next?
Next, we move over to the...
We're moving to a different machine.
Yeah. Take your big tool with you. I love that tool. It's great, isn't it?
And we keep on going.
You just keep going. Keep manipulating. Mm. Remember, I'm going to just pull this up. Remember where it started. It started like that, just a flat piece of steel, and now look at it.
It'll be polished now, and then we'll put the, start putting the slots in.
OK, let's move on then. That is fantastic.
But this is one of my blended paint jobs, so I start with different shades of lime and then blend into green and bring it back up. So always darker on the bottom, lighter on top.
And that was your signature back in the day, wasn't it?
It still is.
It still is.
And then on the hood, it has my skunk stripe. Let me close the hood for you.
All right, sit down the middle.
You call this a bonnet.
We do call this a bonnet. Don't ask me why, but we call it a bonnet.
But see, I have the white pearl blending off very carefully in through here.
Do you see a car and think, immediately, once you see it, I know what I want to do with it?
Yes, I'll study it for 10 or 15 minutes, maybe, and I decide that I can change the taillights and I can change the grill, and then this is how I'm going to paint it. So, yes, I figure that out just very quickly because I've done it over and over.
I think you built cars for, Man From U.N.C.L.E.?
Yes, Man From U.N.C.L.E., Get Smart, TV, and then for movies, I did the original Blade Runner movie. I built 25 cars for that movie. Wow. Back to the Future, I built the police car and one of the DeLoreans they lifted to fly, made the wheels fold under. So
you did that?
Yes.
Wow, Gene, that is fantastic.
And I have a book out now on movie cars, television, and commercials.
That is
and
brilliant.
I did all kinds of commercials.
You even built the space shuttle on the Enterprise on Star Trek, didn't
Star
you?
Trek. I designed it, and then I had an artist do a rendering. I took the rendering to Matt Jeffries, the art director. He says, that's fine, let's go, let's do it. So he okayed it, and I went home and started building.
What a fascinating insight into your history, your design. There's so much history right here in amongst this car collection, but what's your favorite?
My Adam Petty car.
Oh, let me get round there. Let me get round there. So why is this one so special then?
I worked with Adam Petty from the time he started bush racing till just before he passed away, and he is my favorite person in racing. He was the best race car driver I've worked with, the best personality, just a good guy. And when he passed away tragically at New Hampshire, I just put it back, restored it, sat on it. It stays covered 99% of the time, and it's the one car I have that I'll never get rid of.
That tells an amazing story. Oh, somebody's bibbing on their hooter out there. Who's that?
I have some friends coming up who you need to meet. I learned about the history. They lived it.
Well, just can't say hello.
Excellent.
They look like proper racing drivers. Welcome, chaps, to the Field of Dreams. Look at this collection. Hey. Is it amazing? I'm Mike.
Good to see you. Bill Blair, Mike.
Bill Blair, nice to meet you.
Tex Powell.
Tex, very nice to meet
nice
you
to
too,
meet you,
yes.
Mike.
And
Brian,
see you again.
How are
great
you today?
To see you again.
Good to see you guys. Today. Now, you mentioned lunch.
We have a great little place booked out. You can't leave North Carolina without having some good old NC barbecue. We've got a friend who used to be the team manager at Michael Waltrip Racing, opened a spectacular barbecue joint, and that's where we're headed.
Fantastic. What, we're going to go in the old Packard?
Yeah, I think that would be a good plan. It's an American-made luxury car.
It's beautiful.
Mike, I'm going to let you drive because I've seen you do it on TV, and I wondered if you practiced. Now I'll know whether you practice or not.
You don't have to ask me twice. Coming in, gentlemen, let's jump in.
My first race was in High Point Speedway, 1941. And all the great stock car drivers were there that period of time. Bill France, Lloyd C., Roy Hall, Bob Flock, my daddy, Jimmy Lou Allen, and the whole list.
These drivers, were they previous moonshine runners?
Yeah, I'll tell you, my daddy, he inherited a little bit of money, so he bought him a brand new 32 Ford. And he went up to Martinsville on Christmas Eve when he put 125 gallons of white liquor in that 32 Ford. And she was loaded to the brim, and the ATF officer spotted him, and they lit out after him. Now, many people that know that story said that Bill introduced racing to Martinsville because when they get to the town square, they chased him 4 or 5 laps around the town square.
And that's where oval racing comes from.
There you go.